This is the story of Smartlynx Flight 9001. On the 20th of February 2018, a Smartlynx A320 was over the skies of Tallinn, Estonia. It wasn't flying anywhere, it was just a flight to train pilots for the airline. On that day, the plane had a safety pilot, four pilots in training, and a safety inspector on board. And before the flight, they had a safety briefing. Today, each training session would have five touch and goes. For a touch and go, you approach the runway as you would for a normal landing, and then you touch down and take the plane back into the air. It's great practice for pilots. In addition to that, they'd also have one go around and one full stop landing. The first student pilot took the wheel, or the sidestick maybe? As the student pilot did their touch and goes, a warning popped up on the screen. ELAC1 plus ELAC2 pitch faults. The ELAC, or the elevator aileron computer, had an issue. The ELACs, as the name suggests, controls the elevators and the ailerons. The ELACs taken the sidestick inputs and then moved the control surfaces as the pilot commanded. Think of it as a middleman in the chain. The pilot who was monitoring the flight did not think too much of it, and so they did what we all do. They reset the computer to clear the error. We've all done it. Turning it off and then back on fixes a lot of problems, but not today. The first student pilot landed his plane and brought the plane to a stop, and now the second student pilot assumed control of the plane. As student number two took the plane to the skies, the ELAC1 pitch fault error popped up again. Like last time, the system was reset as per procedure. The same thing kept happening during the next touch and go. On the fifth touch and go, an ELAC2 pitch fault error popped up. This happened again on the fourth student's second touch and go. These pitch fault errors kept coming and the resets weren't helping. It was time for the fourth student's third touch and go, and the plane touched down and it was rolling down the runway. The plane then accelerated to 130 knots to lift back into the skies. The instructor asked the student to rotate. He said, "Rotate, rotate," but the plane wouldn't budge. It was stuck to the ground firmly. The pilot replied that he was trying his best to raise the nose of the plane into the air. At this point, a new warning was shown, manual pitch trim only. The pilots would have to manage pitch trim on their own. When you trim an airplane, the airplane stays in a particular state without any inputs from the pilots. So let's say you trim a plane up, then the plane will nose up on its own, but the pilots now had to manage this all on their own. The plane was on the ground. It was as if the pilots were locked out of the controls of their plane. The plane gained so much speed that it lifted off on its own. Sensing trouble, the instructor said, "I have control." As the plane was pitching up and flying away from the airport, the instructor retracted the flaps a bit. The pilot selected gear up, but the plane started to descend and the plane hit the runway. The plane hit the runway and bounced and began to gain altitude at 6,000 feet per minute. As the plane climbed out, they got a flaps lock warning and a warning that alerted them to a fire in engine number two. They weren't out of the woods yet. The pilots kept the plane under control by manually trimming the plane and by using engine thrust. It was hard for them to control the plane. When they pulled back on the power, the plane would dive, setting off the terrain alarm. But somehow, the pilots stabilized the plane at 1,200 feet and they took stock of the situation. The pilot in control asked, "Do we have engines?" The safety pilot replied with, "We have engine 2 fire." They were in dire straits. The elevators were in mechanical backup mode. Engine 1 and 2 were damaged from the bounce, and engine number 2 was on fire, and the flaps were locked in place. The pilots declared a mayday and made a right turn to make a beeline for the airport before anything else failed. As they headed towards the airport, they let the tower know their intentions. "Tallinn Tower, we are going for runway 26. They requested for fire trucks as the right-hand engine was on fire. They started talking about shutting the burning engine down, but they decided to keep it running as they'd need all the help that they could get to get this plane safely down on the ground. Soon after that, the landing gear was extended and engine number 2 failed. On their final approach, engine number 1 failed, killing power to most of the airplane. Only the basics still worked. They had the runway in sight. They were on the home stretch. The safety pilot stated, "Gear is down, we don't have engines." The safety pilot started counting down the airplane's speed. Speed 150. Speed 130. Right after that, the plane touched down hard, 150 meters short of the runway. It decelerated as it went along, and soon it was on the runway. But after a harrowing touchdown, the plane came to a stop to the left-hand side of the runway. The plane was in one piece, and all on board were alive. They had just survived their airborne ordeal. Now, before we go any further, let's just get some acronyms out of the way first. There's quite a few, so much so that I want to call this episode the alphabet soup. Okay, so the ELAC is the Elevator Aileron Computer. The SEC stands for the Spoiler Elevator Computer. The THS is the Trimmable Horizontal Stabilizer, which I'm going to call the Horizontal Stabilizer. The THS OVM is the Horizontal Stabilizer Override Module. And the PTA is the Pitch Trim Actuator. Okay, that's out of the way. With the airplane more or less intact, and with a bunch of pilots who lived to tell the tale, the investigators were able to know that the plane lost pitch control during the flight, and so that's where they focused their efforts. The pitch of the plane is controlled by two elevators and the horizontal stabilizer, the two small wing-like things at the back of the plane. These are massive and are moved by hydraulics. The hydraulic systems are controlled by electrical signals sent by a computer. Yeah, if that computer were to fail, it could lead to a loss of pitch control, and that's why Airbus built an insane amount of redundancy into this pipeline. Usually the stabilizers and the elevators are controlled by the ELAC2 computer. If that were to fail, ELAC1 would take over. If that failed, SEC2 would take over. And if that failed, SEC1 would take over. If that failed, only manual pitch trim would remain. The horizontal stabilizer is fed by three hydraulic lines. And there are three motors, and each of these computers is wired to use a different hydraulic line motor combo, so no matter what, the computers can control the pitch of the plane, or at least that's the idea. Now, you might be wondering, how does the pilot control the horizontal stabilizer? In this chain, right before the trimmable horizontal stabilizer actuator moves the flight control surfaces, there's something known as the THS OVM, or the override module. The override module allows the pilots, as the name suggests, to override the computer at any point. If you've watched a cockpit video, you've probably noticed a spinning wheel in the cockpit between both pilots. That's the trim wheel. The pilot can rotate it to trim the plane up or down. When the pilot does that, a signal is sent to the override module. This causes a disc in the OVM to move downwards. This means that the computer's commands can no longer reach the actuator, as it is physically separated. The pilot now has all the control. But when this happens, a small piston in the override module moves downwards and triggers three PTA micro switches. When these switches are triggered, it sends a signal to the computer saying that they've been overridden. On the accident airplane, as the plane touched down, the computer brought the horizontal stabilizers to 0 degrees, or neutral. But since they were practicing touch and goes, the pilot grabbed the trim wheel and they trimmed the plane to nose up, making it easier for them to take off. When the pilot did this, everything we talked about before happened. The OVM gave the control to the pilot and the piston went down, but the micro switches did not engage correctly. This meant that the computers were not told that they were being overridden. So the computer is commanding all sorts of stuff from the horizontal stabilizer, but it's not going to carry those commands out because the pilot is the one controlling it. So as far as the computer is concerned, the horizontal stabilizer is moving uncommanded, and so the ELAC2 computer, by design, fails. The computer is essentially programmed to go, "Wait, I did not command that. Something is wrong in the system. I should probably step down and let someone take over." And this is how we got the ELAC2 pitch fault warning. But the pilots trimmed the plane on the ground. Why did they get these warnings in the air as they were climbing out? Well, these warnings are inhibited during takeoff so as to not distract the pilots. Since they were being warned about something that happened a while ago, it was hard for them to piece together what was happening. In this way, both ELAC 1 and 2 failed, taking away half their redundancy. But the question still remained, why did the PTA micro switches fail? Why did they fail to inform the computers that they had been overridden? They sent all of the hardware to France where they tested the switches. They found that the activation of the switches were erratic and it was highly dependent on the temperature. The reason for this? they found that the oil used in the THSA and the OVM was not the oil that the manufacturer called for. This oil had a different viscosity value, and so the piston encountered a different amount of friction than what it was designed for, and this meant that the piston could not activate the switches as intended, and that's why the computers had no idea that they were not in control. They couldn't figure out where the wrong oil came from. They guessed that it was from an earlier maintenance check. Now, if you're still watching, you might be wondering, okay, that explains the failure of ELAC 1 and 2. What happened to SEC 1 and 2? Well, to understand that, we need to look at a moment in time. No, literally, a 1.02 second sliver of time where something seemingly insignificant happened. First, let's look at the SEC. The spoiler elevator computer can control the horizontal stabilizer when needed. Much like the ELACs, it too has a command subcomputer and a monitoring subcomputer. It works as you'd think. The command computer sends out commands, and the monitoring computer makes sure that everything's alright. These computers take in all sorts of data from all over the plane. Part of what they do is figuring out if the plane is on the ground or if it's in the air. It takes in data from the landing gears to figure this out. On the accident flight, one of the landing gears was compressed for 1.02 seconds. The plane basically bounced. The monitoring computer picked this up, but the command computer did not because they were working asynchronously and on data with different timestamps. When the landing gear is compressed for a second, it sends the monitoring computer into flight mode, but since the SEC's command computer had not detected the bounce, it stayed in ground mode. This meant that the command computer and the monitoring computer disagreed with each other. Over time, they started to diverge from each other. Remember how I told you that both halves work together? That was not happening. Within a short amount of time, both halves of both SECs disagreed with the other, and by a large margin. Due to this internal disagreement, both SECs failed, and with that, the pilots lost ELAC 1 and 2 and SEC 1 and 2. They no longer had pitch control, they only had manual pitch trim. In a way, this left them locked out of the controls of their plane. No one had expected such a series of unforeseeable events to occur. These events were so unpredictable, from the wrong oil to the precisely timed bounce of 1.02 seconds to a lot of other things. It was a perfect storm, but these pilots were lucky. They managed to walk away from something that no one could have foreseen. Before we wrap up for the day, on a scale of 1 to 10, how much automation do you want on your plane, where 1 is the least and 10 represents the most amount of automation? I'm just curious because whenever I post a video about automation going wrong, I get a lot of comments lamenting the rise of automation. And when I put out a video about a pilot making a mistake, I get a lot of comments calling for more automation. Where do you lie? Let me know in the comments down below. Thank you for watching this episode of Mini Air Crash Investigation. A big thank you to Jan, who's a viewer who helped me out with this video. He's super smart. He programmed the A320 on the Aerofly FS flight simulator, and he really helped me out on this one. So Jan, if you're watching, thank you so much for helping me out on this one. I'll catch you guys next time. Stay safe.